Anpetawashta. What was that? That was an evening greeting in my people's traditional Lakota language. I am absolutely delighted to be here and talk about a subject that I really care a lot about, and I really appreciate this invitation. And John, thank you also for that kind introduction. So what I'm going to talk about basically is this. The general outline is going to be, I'll start by talking about the relationship between mathematics and culture, because there is a theory out there that if there's one topic that you can think of that is totally culture-free, it's got to be mathematics. That's not entirely true, and I want to convince you that there's evidence in native societies of that. Then the central part of my talk is going to be about indigenous Western Hemisphere mathematics. And that's going to be almost exclusively Mayan mathematics. But I'm going to mention that this PowerPoint slide, or this PowerPoint presentation I have, is actually has a lot more slides than I'm going to go through. There are points where you're going to see the little thing on the screen that says skip. I'll click it and I'll go past those. But I also want it to be a document for people who might be interested in seeing some more about it, like what Aztec mathematics was all about, for example. So that'll be in there, and I will leave that here, and anybody, you know, who wants it, you know, check with some of these people, and they should be able to get it to you. I also want to mention, in the central part of this in particular, there's going to be some number theory in there. I also understand that there are, for example, students here who are from courses that, you know, just want to hear about the cultural part of it. Don't worry too much about that, because really what I want you to notice is that the mathematics itself that is being done there actually is quite impressive, even if you and maybe sometimes I don't understand everything that's going on there. It's just the point is that this is mathematics that really was being done in the Western Hemisphere before European contact. I'm going to end the thing by showing why some people believe that the world was going to end 4 years ago because of some Mayan numerology that actually the Maya thought were nonsense, even if the people that were trying to purvey it did not. So that's quite a bit. Let's get on with it here. Why do I care about Native American mathematics? Again, it's this issue about the fact that mathematics can sometimes carry some culture, so in both directions. So does culture influence mathematics, and conversely? I want to start with a couple of quick stories that perhaps might convince you that maybe Native people didn't really care much about mathematics, but then I'm going to try to counter that argument. So this one is from Copper Inuit oral tradition, and it goes like this. This may be a not so positive cultural reflection on pure mathematics, and right away I will apologize to any number theorists in the audience, because they're going to think that you're talking about them, about you. So two hunters return, one with a wolf, the other with a caribou. They begin arguing as to which hide has the most hairs, and in order to settle the argument, decide to have a contest, each pulling the hairs one out one at a time. They count and count and become so engrossed in what they are doing that days pass and they die of hunger. This sort of reminds me of Andrew Wiles locking himself in his attic to prove Fermat's last theorem. He didn't quite die of hunger. But the Inuit storyteller added at the end, that is what happens when one starts to do useless and idle things that can never lead to anything. Well, there goes the interest in my geometry of Banach spaces. What the heck? All right, another story. Actually, another fact. According to early 20th century accounts, among many Crow of that time, it was bad to try to count above 1,000, since honest people have no use for higher numbers. So this book that from which I took these stories really is an excellent read if you're interested in this kind of stuff. But actually, Native people did have a very close cultural involvement. Many Native peoples had a very close cultural involvement with mathematics. And since I am a Lakota guy who is standing on Three Fires ground, Anishinaabe ground in particular, Ojibwe being one of those peoples, I'm going to point out some stuff about a wonderful attitude that they had. I believe it's a very rich attitude that they had just toward number. Here was the idea, and I've actually heard other Algonquian language people, particularly Blackfoot elders in Canada, tell me the same thing, that counting is okay, but the thing is that numbers, if you tell somebody, I have 16 of these objects, and they've never seen those objects, that raw count conveys something very sterile. There are these 16 things, but you have no idea of what they are or what they're like. So their number words actually have, adjoined to them, suffixes that indicate all this rich other stuff about the things that you're describing. So the number words, the suffixes can also indicate dimensionality, manipulability, whether or not the things are organic. So if you have 10 hard inorganic stones, and you see the word, that's the word for 10 in the Ojibwe language. Okay, but you don't just say you have midaswa asinin, you have 10 stones, you say I have midaswa abich asinin to also tell the person with that number word that you have 10 hard inorganic objects that you're calling stones. And then you get a better idea than just this raw naked count of what it is you're talking about. You have other suffixes, minach you can use for 3D organic solids. Well, blueberries certainly satisfy that. So if you want to talk about two blueberries, you say nijo, two, minach, 3D organic, minan, blueberries. And similarly, you can describe four two-dimensional organic muskrat skins by saying you have four muskrat skins and the things that you're talking about are two-dimensional and they are organic. So all of that gets contained in the number words because culturally it just does not seem right to convey only the count. Now, I very much appreciate the advance, but I've got a point now to be able to skip because I have a number of other examples of Ojibwe words in there that anybody who's interested can look at the PowerPoint slide to see, or PowerPoint file to see. This is not unique to Western Hemisphere, native people, to American Indians in both North and South America and Central America. The Maori also have this attitude, which actually has been borne out in their educational system about the importance of understanding a relationship between culture and mathematics. One of these authors of this statement I know, Tony Trinick. He is a Maori fellow. I spent some very interesting time with him in New Zealand talking about this. That he worked on a project also with mathematicians at the University of Auckland and several other, and Maori elders and several other people interested in this, to try to reconstruct a mathematical linguistic in Maori that made sense culturally for them. Now, normally what happens, particularly in portions of the world that have been subject to European contact, where the people spoke an indigenous language, the words in English or French or Spanish just get ported into that language, basically verbatim, with no understanding that there may be some cultural stuff that they carry with them that really doesn't work for that particular culture. Seems hard to believe, but here's the evidence that happens that way. First of all, this is Tony's statement about it. Cultural practices, including ethno-mathematical ones, cannot be separated from the language in which they were developed. Changing the language or the linguistic register in which the practices are discussed will have an impact on how the practices are perceived by students. In particular, if what you're doing is you're porting words into the language that really didn't originate there, this could result in a loss in the fundamental values that would normally accompany the practices, such as for the Ojibwe, okay, the fundamental values that all that other information is supposed to carry in numbers. So what they did was they worked with elders to actually reconstruct, if there ever had been one before, who knows, but to construct a mathematical linguistic that the elders and others said made sense to within the culture of the Maori language. Now, in the early grades, the students in New Zealand, the Maori students in New Zealand get their education in Maori, and at a certain point then they shift to English. What happened was by using this reconstructed linguistic, they noticed a rather dramatic increase in the interest the students had in mathematics when they were taking those Maori courses, and their performance later on when they got into the English language courses. So there is something there about the relationship between culture and mathematics. I always have to mention this in case any of you have ever heard of this, because this is nonsense, but there are people today that still believe it. There's a long-standing piece of folklore, I could have stronger language to describe that, claiming that there is something inherent in us or our cultures that makes us naturally bad at mathematics. And the worst manifestation of this happened in the 1980s when there was a collection of articles that appeared in reputable neuroscience journals, okay, that said there was something genetically about us that made us bad at mathematics. This got all tangled up with what are called hemispheric dominance theories, you know, the left and right brain stuff, and the theory of the right-brained Indian. Okay, all of these results, you know, were either never replicable or they were actually genuinely proven to be wrong. But meanwhile, we had to put up with some of the skull measurers. Okay, you thought that phrenology went out in the 19th century. Okay, well, what harm did this ultimately do? There's a generation of counselors in Indian schools that heard this and believed it. Some of them are still there, and some of them are still counseling their students not to go into mathematics because they're doomed to be bad at it. Okay, so that's just demonstrable nonsense. So could we do mathematics? Okay. Now, whenever you start talking about genetics in American Indians, I and anybody else who does that is on kind of treacherous ground. I will say that the evidence is that genetically there is a lot of similarity between the people who came across the land bridge into this country in several ways, into this hemisphere in several ways. Enough so that if something genetically is making some of us bad at mathematics, you know, some tribes are bad at mathematics, it really ought to be sort of universally affecting us. And that sure is not the case, as the Maya demonstrate. So here are, do you hear the words are? Here are the homelands of the Maya. I didn't say were, because they're still there. Okay, the area around the Yucatan Peninsula is where many Maya people still live. And many of you will, I suspect, have seen the basic Mayan bar and dot system, which is really kind of interesting. It's a base 20 system with numerals, well, from 1 to 19, and another one we're going to talk about, that are formed this way. If you want to write the number 1, there it is, just one dot. 2 dots would be the number 2, 4 dots would be the number 4. Now, at this point in time, if you start, you know, building on that, you're going to end up having things disappear into a sea of dots. So what you do when you get to 5, you say, I'm going to replace 5 by a bar, by smearing those 5 dots together. And then if I want to represent 13, 5, 10, there's 3 dots for 3 more, there's 13. That's the numeral that would indicate 13. And you do that up to 19, and once you get past that, well, you have, the Mayan system is a place value base 20 system. So if this were a Mayan number, let's say, I'm about to put something over on you, but I'm going to end up clarifying in a second, okay? So here's the units position, right? Okay, so you have 12 units. And then in the tens position, oops, 20s position, right? Base 20. So in the 20s position, you have 3 20s. That accounts for 60. And then the next position over, you go up by another factor of 20. This is the 400s position. So here you have 15 400s. One more over, up by another factor of 20. That's 8,000s, and there are 6 of those. You put that all together, and that would be the way that the Maya would represent the number that we call 54,072. Except what I'm putting over on you is not the way that they represent them, because this is the way we do numbers in our Arabic system, right to left with units on the right. The Maya tended to stack these things instead, or put them on their side. There are several different versions that we see in steles in these monuments that appear in Central America. But we can think of it this way. There's no harm in sort of thinking of it that way. But now here's the thing. You have a place value system here, numbering system. What do you have to make a place valuing numbering system work? This is audience participation. If I saw this and I saw this, you got to have a zero, right? The Maya did, and here it is. And there's an interesting, totally false, apocryphal story about this I'm going to tell you. Nowadays, not everything I'm saying is going to be a lie, I promise, okay? I'll warn you when it is, okay? What's that? That's clearly a picture of something, right? It's a pictograph. So what is it? Almost universally, and I agree, I've seen the evidence, I believe, and ethnomathematicians, which I am not one, but they seem to be fairly universally agreed that that is a picture of a shell, a seashell or something like that. Reasonable, right? There's another thing that back in the middle part of the 20th century, some ethnomathematicians believed it could be instead. And wow, I would sure like to know if there's any chance that they're right. Okay, and so but they're not, okay? It really is a shell. But let's suppose we project ourselves back to 1940, and we have two ethnomathematicians who are sitting here quarreling with each other about what that picture is, and one of them says, that's a shell. And the other one says, no, wait a minute, most of the Maya did not live on the shore. It's a leaf. Shell, leaf, shell, leaf. Right? And then it occurs to one of this flash of true genius and insight. How can we settle this? And we know in a moment of you know, wonderful revelation in his head, he says, why don't we ask a Mayan? Okay, so they get on a boat and they go down the Yucatan Peninsula and they find a Mayan elder. By the way, this story is totally apocryphal. I've heard it, but it just has all the earmarks of apocryphal, all right? So it is. But it's just still too good not to tell. So they go down and they find a Mayan elder who is totally versed in the number system, and they say to him, we need to know what this is. And the one says, yeah, because it's obviously a shell. And the other one yells, leaf, shell, leaf. And the Mayan elder is sitting there thinking, you know what they say about these academics is right. The arguments are so fierce because the stakes are so small. All right, so he says, stop. Isn't it obvious? Well, yeah, it's obvious. It's leaf, shell, no. He says, okay, now this again is audience participation. I need you all to sort of speak up on this. How many?
Five,
right? How many?
Four.
How many?
Three.
How many?
Two.
How many?
One.
How many?
Zero.
Do you see it? Okay, I would like that to be true. What difference does it make? It's a big one. Look, if you're doing sand reckoning on the shore with a stick and you're, you know, writing down a number and you say, wait a minute, I'm not going to put anything there and I've got to put something there. And you look around, you see a shell and you just grab it and shove it in there. That's one thing. But having something that represents a number that means one less than this, that means nothing at all, that is a much deeper thought. Okay, and I really wish that we could show that's true. You can't because there was way too much that was lost in the conquest. Okay, so we won't know. And yeah, the evidence is very strong that it really is a shell. But I could wish, can't I? Okay, so my point was showing you Yucatec words in a tone language that if there are any Ojibwe people in the audience, you know that I better apologize for my pronunciation of your words. Well, this would go a whole lot worse if it's a tone language, and I can't do that. But I can at least sort of get the pronunciation right because I had a Mayan walk me through this once going like this. Okay, and there's a point to this because actually there is something here that also talks about how number and mathematics can convey culture. So just go through these. Let me just quickly go through these words. Hun, ka, oh, kan, hu, huak, huak, wahak, balon, lahun, buluk, lacha. Well, you see some kind of relationship between this number for 12 and the word 2, but there didn't seem to be any between 11 and 1. Basically, you have 12 unique numbers here. The way that the 12 unique names for numbers, okay, which apparently they had enough use for that they gave them unique names. So once you hit 13, look what happens. It gets real mechanical now. Ochlahun, 13, well that's Ochlahun. 14, same thing. You're just 13 through 19, all you do is you go over here, 19. Balonlahun, you take the number, okay, 10, and you append to whatever the front of it is, whatever you have to do to bring it up to that number. Then finally you get to Kal, which is a different number. Okay, but somehow they saw a special need for numbers 1 through 12. Okay, and that might that might indicate, if we didn't all know already know it's true, that maybe the Maya had a lot of interest in trade and merchandising. Because when you have unique numbers like that for 1 through 12, frequently that means that you're interested in selling things in batches of 12. Okay, or having that as your standard lot size, and there's a real good reason for that that has to do with divisibility. Okay, my father-in-law was an egg farmer, and he always sold eggs by the dozen, which is handy because if you have one standard batch of eggs, you could sell people either the whole batch, or half of it, or a third of it, or a fourth of it, or a sixth of it, or of course single eggs too. Okay, that's fine, that's handy. But on the other hand, if your standard lot size is 10 and somebody wants a third of that, you're gonna have a real mess on your hands, won't you? So that could indicate that maybe there was some interest in trade and batch sizes. Okay, so there's an example where culture can convey something, or, well, mathematics can convey something about a culture. Okay, if you've ever seen 18 Rabbits Granola, it's some real high-class coffee shops carry that stuff. Actually, if you look on the box, frequently they'll have this little story about it that contains that number that we just saw for 18, Wahachlun. That's a little bit different spelling, but here's the Wikipedia explanation, which is pretty close to what they tell you on the box. 18 rabbit was a Mayan ruler. Okay, and this stuff is named after him for some reason. Okay, so that's just a barely outside chance you've seen that word before. The Maya had two calendrical systems that they ran simultaneously. And that had a lot of interesting mathematical consequences. So, do you all have a copy of that sheet that I handed out? Okay, could you turn? I wasn't quite planning on doing it this way. Turn to the side, but I'm going to. The side that says parsing Mayan dates. Okay, and at the top of that, I have an example of something called a calendar round date. I won't define that quite yet, but you see, it says, for Ahau et Kumku. Now, the Maya had a vague year, okay, that consisted, or Hop in their language, in Yucatec, that consisted of 18 months of, I'm putting months in quotes, it doesn't have anything to do with the moon, okay, but 18 months of 20 days each, that accounts for 360 days, and then there's this little residual period of 5 days at the end of the year. It was called the vague year because of the lack of a leap year, so it did not sync completely with the solar year. They had that little deficit there. The little deficit in the 365 days. It has to be made up by a leap year. The Maya knew that. They knew that this didn't stay in perfect sync with the actual solar year, but they didn't really care very much because over the course of one person's lifetime, it wasn't going to get that far out of sync. And besides, getting out of sync with the seasons in Central America wasn't such a big deal when the seasons really aren't that much of a big deal themselves, okay? But by the way, occasionally you'll see claims that the Maya had computed the solar year to be 365.2422 days, which is the correct number, that's generally considered to be nonsense. If you see it, ignore it. So that's one of the two calendars. There was also the second calendar called the Sacred Round or Tsulkane Sequence of Days that consisted of two cycles running simultaneously, one of which was The whole thing ran simultaneously with the vague year cycle of 365 days, and one of those two cycles in the sacred round had repeated every 13 days, had a cycle length of 13 days, and the other cycle repeated every 20 days. Now, but for the moment, let's go back and take a look at this vague year. That's the one that's easier to think about because it kind of works a lot like our calendar does. So here are the vague year month names. Remember, I had 18 of, okay, so first I should point out on this sheet that says parsing Mayan dates, ignore the calendar round part and just look at that date for Ahau 8 Kumku. In there, the vague year date is the 8 Kumku part. Now, we have these 18 months of 20 days each to account for 360 days. And at the end, we have this little five-day stubby month that you call Y-Hep. It only had 5 days in it. Okay, now you see the 8 Kumku just means that in the month of Kumku, the 18th 20-day month of a year, okay, that was just the 8th day of that month. Okay, just like we would say the 8th day of March. No difference at all. So, yep, the vague year dates were named just as you would expect. So Pop was the first month of the year. So you started with one Pop, two Pop, you went up to the 20th day of the year was 20 Pop, and then you started with the second month. Well, and it was one Huo, two Huo, all the way up through 20 Huo, and so forth until you got to the end. And those 5 days were one Huayeb, two Huayeb, three Huayeb, four Huayeb, five Huayeb. There were variations for the last day of the month that for a time might have excited some people into thinking that maybe the Maya had a different meaning for zero, but just besides a placeholder. But it's kind of doubted that they really did. So the last day of the month might be called 20 Pop. But you could also leave a number out and just say end of pulp and mean the same thing. Or you could say seeding of wool. And if you said that, that's when some people got excited and said, whoa, they're talking about the zeroth day of wool. They would not have thought of it that way. They just meant that it's coming right there next day. All right, now, here on the first slide, you saw that little funny thing down here on the lower left corner? Remember that? You, of course, remember everything that was on every slide I've shown, right? Okay, I would go back and show it to you, except it'd take me a long time to get back here. In the lower left corner, this was there, and that actually is a vague year date. So that fourth month in that list was called Tsots. Okay, and what this represents is Ochlehon 13, the 13th day of the month of Tsots. This little head variant thing is what it's called. That little image indicates the month of Tzotz. So that's how they would likely represent that. That's how they would represent that. Now, that takes care of the 8 Kumku part. The first part, the 4 Ahau, is from the sacred cycle, and that works a little bit differently. The sacred cycle has 20-day names that are listed like this, Imich, Ik, and so forth, all the way up through Kawak and Ahau. Ahau will appear again. So you might want to remember that is the 20th day name. Those were kind of like weekdays in the sense we might say, well, how do the days go when you're thinking about weekdays? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Repeating cycle of size 7. This is the same thing except their week was 20 days long. So they would say if today is Imich, tomorrow will be Ik, the day after will be Akbal, and 19 days from now will be Ahau, and then the 20th day from now would be Imich again. So that was a 20 cycle, and running in parallel with that, we had day numbers, sometimes called, this kind of getting overwhelming. There's a way to fix this to make it less overwhelming, and that's what we're going to do as soon as we get all of this stuff out of the way, respecting the fact that we should say the way that the Maya did it. Okay, we had this other cycle running in parallel, numbering the consecutive days, except that repeated at 13. So you had one imi, okay? If you started with one imi, you had the first day, the first number, the first day name. Then you went to the all the way up to the 13th number, the 13th day name. And the next day still had the 14th day name, and continue on down to the 20th, except now you've got to start this cycle over again at 1. Okay? Two cycles running in parallel. Whew, you put all this together, and you have calendar round dates now, which is what I claim that you had on that sheet that I handed out. And this is really the way that the Maya always did this. They would have not just one or the other, but they, whenever they talked about a date, they would talk about both the sacred date, that 13 cycle and 20 cycle are running together, and they would also talk about the day and the 365 day year, and they would write them side by side. So on that sheet you have where it says, okay, at the top, four ahau eight kumku, the four ahau, the four is your place in the 13 day number cycle, the ahau is your place in the 20 day, okay, day name cycle, and the eight kumku tells you where you are in the year. Okay, now the whole thing seems to have disappeared into a collection of Mayan words with some numbers intermingled. So how about if we do this instead? And this is what the modern convention is. Okay, down at the bottom of the page, you see that ordered triple, 4, 20, 348. So what you can do is take this 4 ahau and 8, 4 ahau 8 kumku and say, okay, the sacred round date is 4 ahau. That means the fourth day in the 13-day cycle, and ahau is the 20th day name. That's the 20th day in the 20-day cycle. So you represent that as just 4, 20, a whole lot simpler. And it turns out that 8 kumku, computation is done here for you, 8 kumku is the 348th day of the year. So you just say, okay, we'll write 348 for that. We have a nice ordered triple that contains all that information and all of that Yucatec language and makes it a lot easier to think about. But that is a modern convention. The Maya just reveled in doing it the other way. So this is just what was on that slide, okay, that I just gave you. So, problem one. Now I'm going to do a little bit of number theory here, and I'm just going to ask you to believe the results. Okay, the mathematicians will know how I'm computing it. So the first question is this. What you really have here are three cycles running simultaneously. A 13 cycle, okay, a 20 cycle and a 365 cycle. So the question is, if you're at position, when you put all that together, the calendar round position, the position you are in those two calendars on a particular date, 420, 348, how long is it going to be before that date appears again? Which will be the same as asking, how many different calendar round dates can there be? Okay? And it turns out that what you do is you just compute the least common multiple, the number that is the smallest positive multiple of those three different cycle lengths. And that is 18,980, which for some reason I wrote here as 52 times 365, which it is, right? That's 52 times 365. Days. Now imagine this. Somebody is born on the date 4 ahau 8 kumku, which we've just written as 4, 20, 348. What would that person consider to be their really significant birthday? It's going to be the day that 4 ahau 8 kumku happens again, right? So with that sort of leading introduction. What did the classical Maya consider to be the natural human lifespan? Let's see. That's how many different dates there are, 52 times 365. 52 years, right? And if somebody actually managed to hit their second birthday, there was just, which people did, you know, there'd be a whale of a celebration. I doubt if anybody ever made three of them. Okay, but people did live to be 104 years old, even considering that those years aren't exactly the years that we would think of. Now, distance numbers. We're actually closing in now on the end of the world. So, distance numbers. Okay, turn to the back of that sheet, and you'll see this distant numbers in the long count. Just go over the distance number part of it. The Maya loved to compute the difference between in days between two given dates. Every time they talked about this date and this date, it seemed like they always had on a stele that talked about this, on a monument that talked about this. They would have to tell you how many days there were between those things, and their computations, so far as we know, were always right, which is significant. So, for distance numbers, we're going to talk about the number of days between two dates. Okay? And one way we could talk about that, we could write some notation down like this, okay, and say, well, there's days, there's 20-day units, 400-day units, okay, 8,000-day units, and so forth. We do that, you know, like it's just sort of like their base 20 numbering system. And to do that, that is what they did with one small modification. Okay, this is days, this is 20-day units. They call these kins. Okay, these are 20-day units, which they call winnels. And these, well, are they 400-day units? That's awfully close to what they considered to be a year. So how about instead going from here to here, instead of multiplying by 20 just for that one case, multiply by 18 instead. You get 360. And that pseudo-year is what they actually put in there. It turns out that there's mathematical reasons that that makes some computations really, really easy if you do that. Okay, if you think about adding two things about this, just think that you just carry, you know, you carry an addition. Instead of carrying 20s at that one place, you carry 18 instead. Okay, it really makes it really slick and easy to add these things, and they no doubt took advantage of that. So, if the Maya wanted to talk about the difference between two dates, they could say, well, it's okay, 13 kins, 8 winnels, 11 tunes, 3 katuns. Okay, so these are like days, months, 360 days, pseudo years. Okay, these are 20 year, pseudo year periods. And these things over here are 400 pseudo year periods. Okay, now, by the way, they're called, so this is called a katun. This thing is called a baktun, except that that word is the one word here that really is just a modern invention. But a baktun is just give you some idea of how big these things are. That's 144,000 days. Now, so here's an example from a Mayan inscription. And now look, having sat through all of this, you can all actually read Mayan. So let's take a look at this. Well, actually, you can. You can at least see which pieces of this go with what's actually on this stele. This is a sketch of a real stele, okay? On 8 oak, you see the 8? There's 8 oak. 13 yach, well, you see the 13, and that's the yach, was born Bird Jaguar, Lord of Yaxchilan. Now, they could have just said, on then, at a later date, on 11 Ahau 8 sec, he was seated in his rulership of Yaxchilan, except they don't do that. They also have got to tell you how many days apart those things are. It's just like a compulsion. Okay? So they said the distance number was then 10 kins, 5 winnels, 3 tuns, and 2 katuns, which you can represent this way. Okay? After which, on 11 Ahau Itzak, he was seated in this rulership. At least these were a bunch of, you know, primitive people in Central America. Would they get this right? Always, as nearly as we can tell. And that kind of indicates maybe something was going on behind the scenes about the way they were doing these computations. And again, I stress that too much was lost during the conquest, to be sure. But particularly for the folks who know how to do this computation, Okay, I'm not inviting you to do it on the fly here, okay? And for those who don't, I'd just like you to take a look and think about the fact that the mathematics is happening. It looks pretty impressive. Okay, so here's what you can do. You start with a date, giving as your place in the 13 cycle, your place in the 20 cycle, and your place in the 365 vague year cycle. Start with that. And later, you arrive at a later date. So start at T0, V0, Y0, starting date. You arrive at a later date after a distance number that you can write like this. Okay, N5, N4, N3, N2, N1, okay? So that happens. So what you would like to do, if you know these two things, okay, if you want to check this computation, you know the beginning date represented that way. You can figure that out from the language. And you know the distance number. That's given to you also. So you might want to check to see if you really do arrive at that ending date that they claim. Here's what you have to do. Some number theory. For those who are familiar with clock arithmetic or modular arithmetic, that's what we're going to do. So one baktun, that's 400 pseudo years. As I mentioned already, that's 144,000 days. Well, it turns out that that's equal mod 13 to negative 1, and it's equal mod 20 to 0. 20 clearly divides that number. Okay, and it's equal to 190 mod 365. So first, you've got to know that. Then you do the same thing for katuns, okay? Those 20 pseudo-year periods. That's 7,200 days. That's equal to negative 2 mod 13, 0 mod 20, and negative 100 mod 365. You do the same thing for tuns, those pseudo-years, and the weenals, and the keens, and you get that whole collection of, you know, modular equivalences there. And now you have these formulas. Just take a look at these formulas. Okay, if you start at this date, T0, V0, Y0, so in particular, if you start at this starting position in the 13 cycle, and you want to know what the ending position is in the 13 cycle, here's what it is. T, the ending position will be the starting position, minus 1 times N5, the rightmost position in that distance number, minus 2N4 minus 4N3 plus 7N2 plus 1 times N1. Where did the minus 1, minus 2, minus 4, 7, and 1 come from? Well, right here. There's the minus 1, minus 2, minus 4, 7, and 1. They came from those modular equivalences. And then your position in the 20 cycle, okay, is given by that formula. You can find your ending position in the vague year this way, and that's given by that formula. But you're interpreting mod 13 here by mod 20, and here you're interpreting that mod 365. Okay, so you know, you can haul out your favorite junior, senior level number theory book like, you know, Niven, Zuckerman, and Montgomery or something. And you dig through it, you know, and you think, well, yeah, I guess I see why that's true. Would the Maya have known how to have read, you know, a book like that that we use in junior, senior mathematics? As some ethnomathematicians, I think many, including Michael Kloss, believes that they did these computations for, you know, it may have looked different the way that they did it, the process they went through, but they actually did them just exactly the way that we do them, that they knew how to do that number theory that I just put up there. Because they had brilliant people, mathematicians were very highly valued people in their societies, okay, who were doing this kind of things for hundreds of years. They would have figured it out, okay, rather than just sit there and say, I think I'll figure out what the distance number is here, and I'm going to sit down and scratch out 146,000 lines and hope I don't forget one of them. Okay. Yeah, no, they would have, they almost certainly would have just known how to do this. But again, too much is lost to be sure. So let's check the computation, and I'll just say that if you actually do the computation, Bird Jaguar was done on the sacred date, 8th position in the 13th cycle, Auk, okay, 20th day in the 20th cycle, 13, yeah, well anyway, 810 I guess that is actually. And then that's 193rd day of the year. And that's the distance number. Here's where you arrive at the end. And the ending date is 11 Ahawit Sek, just exactly as claimed on that stele. They got it right. I'm just going to leave this for any number theorists out there who like to do this little problem. So here's another one. Pakal, perhaps the greatest of all Mayan kings, certainly the greatest known one, the best known one, Lord of Palenque. There's this problem on his, there's this thing that's written on his sarcophagus that sounds suspiciously like an algebra problem that he's inviting somebody to solve. Okay, on this date he was born, on this date he died, and he lived through parts of four cartoons, parts of four of those 20-year periods, right? King Pakal, Lord of Palenque. So the problem is, it's not stated, but you know, somebody can scratch your head and say, well, how old was he when he died? The interesting part is, without actually giving you the distance number, they've given you just exactly the clue that you need to solve this uniquely. That part that he lived through four parts of four cartoons. It's almost as they're inviting mathematicians of the future to figure out how old he was. Okay. Anyway, so the long count and the end of the world. So now you know everything about distance numbers, which is what you need to know to decide whether or not the world ended 4 years ago. Do you remember that other thing that was on the opening slide? That little list of numbers separated by dots, that was today's date in the Mayan long count system. Did you notice that everything I've talked about concerning dates doesn't actually give you an absolute date? Because if today is 4 Ahau 8 Kumku, that doesn't tell you exactly when something happened, because 4 Ahau 8 Kumku is going to occur again 52 years in the future. But they did have an absolute numbering system. And rather than look at this, let's take a look at the back of this sheet where it says the long count. Okay, this was the day, these were the days computed as distance numbers, which we just talked about, from a starting date way in the past, a particular starting date way in the past. And here is the story, the Mayan creation story that leads to this. In their cosmology, they believed that it took the gods 13 baktuns, they didn't actually have that word, but 13 of those units, 13 baktuns, 13 144,000 day periods to create a world that people could actually live in. And on the final day of that period, okay, so from the very start of time, 13 baktuns have passed. And they said, what happened is on that day, actually the darkness lifted. Does this sound like other stories you might have heard? Okay, let there be light. Okay, the darkness lifted, and at that point the world was ready for habitation by humans. Okay, so that was the end of that period, and 13 baktuns had passed. So the next day, he would say, see this thing, sort of every day of the past, this would have been one bigger until it reached 13 baktuns like this. So maybe you would say, well, the next day should be called 13001, but they said, no, a whole new era has started, so we're going to reset the odometer back to 00001. Okay? That'll be the first day of the new universe in which humans can be. So, what turns out that if you know where they got this, and you take a look at long count dates on Mayan monuments, you actually have enough information to nail down what their starting date would have been. So they run from about, you know, 8.12, 8 baktuns, 12 katuns after the first day humans could be there. That was about 300 AD, Common Era. And it goes up to about 10,400 in 900 AD, 900 Common Era. And there's enough information that actually ethnomathematicians are fairly confident that the Mayan base date was August 11th, 3114 BC. You have to be careful about what calendar you're talking about. So we're talking about the proleptic Gregorian calendar. Remember that funny thing about Julian and Gregorian calendars that had happened a few centuries back where they had to correct the old calendar? Well, the proleptic Gregorian calendar is the one in which you take the calendar that exists now, assume it's always been there, and project backward. Okay, so it's a Gregorian calendar projected backward into time. So it places the Mayan base date there. And what happens when the odometer flips again? Okay, well, the gods had no use for a date in creation past 13,000. So once the odometer started rolling again, we shouldn't expect them to have any use for a date past 13,000. And supposedly the wise Maya completely understood the workings of the universe and knew that the modern world could not last longer than its creation. Thus, when the calendar would get to that number again, on that day or the next, it's over. So, when did that happen? Okay, here, you know, this is like, using this system, this is like 99999, right, with the calendar ready to flip. 12, 19, 19, 17, 19, which by the way, incidentally, happens to be 3 Coac, 2 Conquin, as the calendar round date. That was December 20th, 2012. The next day was 13,000. Okay, that's December 21st, 2012. So lots of people, you know, gave away everything they had, went outside and waited for, you know, what's it called? The rapture, yes, that's it, thank you. Waited for the rapture. And there is evidence that it didn't happen. Okay. Now, by the way, today, assuming you can let this calendar keep going, today would be 13,045,19, which is what that date was on the first page. Okay, I'm not making fun of the Mayan, because the Mayans say, when all this is going on, they said, we never believed this. Okay, and you know the response is, yes, you did. All right, well, I'm not going to say much about the Aztecs, because I'm within a few minutes of getting my hour through my hour. I would kind of like not to hold you longer than that. I do want to say something, though, about the Mexica people, mistakenly called the Aztec. That was a misunderstanding in a conversation that occurred between one of the Spaniards and a Mexica person. Okay, the Mexica also had a really, really fine numbering system, which is described on the next 46 slides or something in great detail. But look, if you're interested in that, you can go look at it, okay, because it's on there. But you see that little thing there that says skip? We're going to click it. And I'll go down if I can get pointed to it, looking at this thing from an angle of about 30 degrees. Let's see. And we're going to go to the last very few slides. Ah, there we go. So all I'm going to say about the calendrical system of the Mexica people is, by the way, they're still there too. There's still 5 million people down there who speak Nahuatl, the traditional Aztec language, as their first language. So the Aztec have not gone anywhere either. Okay, their calendrical system is similar to the Maya. It had, in fact, they got it from the Maya. Okay, it has a 13 cycle and a 20 cycle together. Gives you the sacred cycle, and it has the 365-day vague year, but it has a special feature. A year is known by the sacred, they actually give the year's names, the years meaning the vague year's names. They're known by the sacred day name of the 360th day of the year, the last day before that little stubby 5-day month starts. A year is known by that date. So, and it turns out, of the 260 possible sacred day names, Exactly, 52 are used, and they occur in a cycle of 52. Okay, again, one person's lifetime, sort of. Now, here is a legend of Keakatl Tupilsin that sometimes is conflated with a Mexica deity, Quetzalcoatl, the feathered serpent. They are actually different, okay, but they're sometimes conflated. Okay, here is a legend. This was the legendary ruler of the Toltecs, the old ones, the builders of Teotihuacan, this amazing city, precursors the Mexica. The city was already a ruin by the time the Mexica people got there. Okay, well, those were the Toltecs. Now, I'll mention that this all is disputed, it's controversial, but supposedly the legend was that Keakatl Tupilsin, you know, the Arthurian legend, the once and future king, that Keakatl Tupilsin would return to resume his rule in a year that was named Keakatl, hence his name, Keakatl Tupilsin. He would return in such a year. One read. Akatl is a 13th sacred day name. When does Cortez have to show up? Okay. Now, the thing was that this was considered to be a white god. And now, look, the Europeans who arrived there under Cortez, they had guns and they had horses, but the Mexica Empire was mighty. It really was. It was a very strong, very, very strong empire. And given the numbers of the Europeans, the Mexica could have shoved them just right back into the sea. But here's your problem, okay? Here's Cortez, it's Keakatl. Cortez is a white guy. Am I about to try to kill Keakatl Tupilsin? You know, it does not go well with you if you kill off your gods. And so this actually paralyzed the emperor, Moctezuma, and he just could not do anything. Now, by the time that actually one of his generals kind of whipped him back into shape and convinced him that something was seriously wrong, that gave Cortez the opportunity to go around and recruit the neighboring tribes, and the Mexica people were not very kind to them. They were, you know, taxing the daylights out of them and taking their people for sacrifices and everything. So he made alliances with them, and you couple that with the disease that was brought and sort of decimated the Mexica people, and that is what led to the conquest. So in one funny way, you might almost say, and I don't want this to be discouraging any of you from taking a number theory course, okay, but the conquest happened because you could argue that the Central American people knew too much number theory. Okay, I don't know if there's a moral in there. But if you're interested in this story, here's where I'll point you to where you can learn more about it. For more on that story and on Mexica mathematics, including the symbol, it's actually there for a caudal reed, take a look at this poster, Math of the Aztecs, that you're going to find on the wall outside A2155 Mackinac Hall. Okay, it's all there. And in fact, it even extends on this, even expands on this a little bit. I will warn you, there's a couple of things I quarrel with. I think that they do make the equation, they try to equate Keakatl Tupilsin with Quetzalcoatl, and that is not quite right. And also, they don't point out some of this is disputed. However, it has a ring of truth, it really does. And I do believe that there's a good chance that at least most of it is true. And it's laid out very nicely with a lot of nice pictographs on that particular poster. While you're at it, please also take a look at the other posters that are up there that talk to you, that tell you all about how mathematics has been done in other cultures and what the cultural importance of all of that is. It's really a very nice display. And I'm going to actually finish with one last thing, which is sort of, if I can hit that skip thing. Here. Okay. You probably figured out that stories about colonial systems have lots of apocryphal things and things that aren't sure about them. That's a good way of, you know, having stories that are really sound, interesting, maybe aren't quite as true as you might think that they would be. How many people know that our months, September, October, November, and December, which obviously got named after the Latin septem, octo, novem, decem, because they're the 7th, 8th, and 9th, 10th months. But wait a minute, they're not. They're the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th. I won't ask you to raise your hand, but almost everybody knows that's because the Caesars shoved those 2 months right into the middle of the calendar that pushed things two months farther into the future, which for you the future is that way, right? Okay, pushed it 2 months farther into the future. Okay, that is not the reason. Now, I'm going to let you do the research to see what the real reason was. And you can do it by answering this research problem, which just requires just a tiny amount of web research. Okay? George Washington was born February 11, 1731, but that was by the Julian calendar, which the colonies were still using then. Now, the Julian calendar had fallen behind the Gregorian calendar at that point by 11 days due to the lack of leap years. And most of the rest of the world had already converted to the Gregorian calendar, and the colonies finally did too. It actually took the colonies longer to do it than it took Britain to do it. But so it was corrected to February 22nd, 1732. Well, there's the 11 days, but why did the year jump from 1731 to 1732? Once you know that, you'll know the real story about why those months are called September, October, November, and December. And with that, Pilamaya, thank you for listening to me. And I hope the next time somebody tells you that mathematics is culture-free, you can stick out your tongue and go, pfft, I know better. Thank you.